Welcome to the video. The views keep coming, so I keep talking. I don't know where the views are coming from. Don't know if many are being helped. Some have said this is helpful for them, so that's great. It's a pretty small demographic here. And the question is, has spiritual teaching, guidance towards truth, has it helped anyone in the world? If one looks at this world right now, it's hard to say that it has helped much at all. How can we determine if it has helped or not? Well, it's very simple. If one is clear about and accepting about the idea that one has to choose a different idea, or exchange belief systems, for instance, as Jesus puts it in A Course in Miracles, exchange belief systems, I put it, choose a new idea. If one sees that that is the remedy, then real progress has been made. So I would say in my situation, real progress has been made, but not entirely satisfactory. I do not know anyone who has had entirely satisfactory progress where they have actually chosen a new idea. Not for sure. Don't really know. So the question is, has any progress been made? I don't see much. Because real progress is considering the idea of exchanging belief systems, putting that in the forefront. Because until that is put in the forefront, one is simply being guided by the ego and seeming to go a lot of places, but really going nowhere. Seeming to entertain a lot of spirituality, but not making any true progress at all. It's easy for one to be led like this lifetime after lifetime. Being a benefactor, a charitable person, a good person, a righteous person, a deep thinker, philosopher, all these things are very possible, but they get us nowhere. Freedom isn't seen until one entertains the idea of exchanging belief systems or choosing a new idea. At that point, something different emerges from the search, from one's path. And one realizes, wow, this is a new ball game that we're talking about here. Exchanging belief systems, setting one down and picking another one up. Not trying to fix a belief system, exchanging belief systems. Not trying to fix the world, but choosing a new idea. Not trying to fix the effects of an idea, but choosing a new idea. That's a totally different ballgame. Only that is real spiritual inquiry and consideration. Everything else is just window dressing. It's compensation. I just locked the cat indoors and now he's out again. How is that possible? I don't know. Very clever. As far as I know, there is no way out once the cat door is shut. But he's back outside again. Isn't that interesting? Oh my gosh. Well, that's like our spiritual path. We think we've got it pinned down, but it keeps slipping away from us. So it's important to turn to the notion of exchanging belief systems, choosing a new idea, as the only way. Realize that's the only remedy. And then that truly does pin it down. And of course, we will keep trying to revert to what we're familiar with. Happens to everyone, happens to me. Even as I do this after doing this video, tomorrow it'll seem like I've forgotten what I even said. Which is frustrating. The problem is that there's no real progress except in getting closer to choosing a new idea, exchanging belief systems. And until one actually does that, it doesn't seem as though one has done anything. And it's true that one has not. One has not fixed the problems of the world at all. And one's so-called persona is still in fragments, which it always is, because there is no real I behind the persona that's giving rise to the persona. It's just an assumption. The I is an assumption. It's a false point of origin that holds our attention, thinking that something is coming from an I when actually there is no I. It's a misdirection to be believing that there's an I where all of this is arising from. Our so-called persona is arising from that. It's not true. What we call our persona is simply the arising of this delusionary play of forgetting what we are. And this mad scrambled eggs of existence with all these different, all these effects intersecting like an ocean, chop on an ocean, all the waves and the chop and everything going here and there. No real rhyme or reason. And then we, in a particular place in time and space, there's a particular mishmash of these effects taking place, and we feel that, register that, record it, and believe that that is coming from some I. I is giving rise to this, when in fact that is never the case. What is giving rise to it is the idea of wanting to be prime creator, of spirit wanting to be prime creator, gives rise to all of this. And only that desire on the part of spirit to be prime creator is giving rise to this. It's the only source. There's no I source for any of it. Again, that is just imaginary tactic of misdirection to keep us from looking at what's really giving rise to it. Because once we see what's giving rise to it, we'll say, ah, I could choose a different idea. Right? Of course. Spirit is simply entertaining this idea. Spirit just said, come here, let's entertain me for a while, this idea, entertain me for a while. And Spirit is being entertained by this idea, hosting this idea. And as Spirit hosts it, Spirit is witnessing to this idea and seeing what comes of it. And what comes of it is Spirit falling into a state of deep, deep forgetfulness of what it is. And the Bible says, Adam ate of this fruit and fell into a deep, deep sleep. The fruit in the middle of a garden is the fruit of wanting to be prime creator. What's in the middle? The prime creator. Everything extends out from the point of origin. So to eat of the fruit in the middle of the garden means to eat, to entertain the idea of being prime creator. And that's what Spirit did. Remember, Spirit was warned. You can eat of all the fruits in the garden, meaning ideas. The garden is reality. And in the garden, in reality, are all ideas, infinite ideas. There's only one idea that we should not choose, that is the idea of being prime creator. Because when we do that, we have to forget what we are. We have to forget that we are prime created. We have no choice but to fall into a deep, deep sleep of forgetfulness. That's exactly what has happened to us. We're still in the garden with all ideas available to us, but we have forgotten what we are. We've forgotten where we are. We've forgotten that we can choose a new idea. We have forgotten all of this. We're identified with this imaginary I, with an imaginary self. It doesn't even exist. It's just an assumption. And then we get teachers that come here and tell us this, and we don't have any idea what they're talking about. And they say, how can I get enlightened? There is no I to get enlightened. It's spirit needs to choose a new idea, not some I to be get enlightened. The whole thing about I getting enlightened just reinforces the notion that there is some I that is giving rise to something. Not true. And we dream we're some fragment of some soul on a journey. You know, that's a dream. We're dreaming this, we're a soul on some journey, learning and gathering experiences and growing and all of this stuff. So it's all part of the dream. We fall into a deep, deep sleep, forgetful of what we really are. Because we ate of the fruit in the middle of the garden, the idea of being prime creator. Reality extends from the origin, the prime creator. It expands in all directions. Ideas expand. But creation goes in one direction, from the center outwards, from the prime creator. It starts there. And for spirit, which is the expansion of the prime creator, part of the expansion of that, the expanding and the experiencing of this, of all ideas. When ideas chosen, it expands. That's what spirit is. Spirit's not the prime creator. So when spirit chooses to want to be the prime creator, that idea, spirit cannot know what it is. It cannot know that it's prime created. It has to deny this, to forget it, to fall into a deep, deep sleep of forgetfulness. And the remedy, only remedy, is a deep remembrance, perfect remembrance of what spirit is. Or just a sudden shift back into direct functioning. But that's too abrupt. From the standpoint of spirit, it would seem that's too abrupt. So the remedy is a deep remembrance. That's all the remedy is. That's all it is. So spiritual progress means seeing this, starting to see this as the remedy, instead of chasing after all these illusory remedies. And I'd have to say their number is legion, endless. An endless outpouring, a continuous outpouring of bogus remedies, always is occurring in existence. Why? To distract us away from what the true remedy is. Just like the eye distracts us away from the origin of all this. All these bogus spiritual remedies distract us away from exchanging belief systems. Choosing a new idea. Choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator, as I put it. That's the true remedy for our situation. Because that brings about deep remembrance. Brings about what I call the overlay, what some call the vision of oneness, vision of Christ. The overlay. Which is one effect overlaying all other effects. And that effect remains untouched or unchanged by any effects. There's no negation of that effect taking place at all, and that reminds us of what we really are. It's the perfect reminder. And once we're perfectly reminded, then it's easy to function as we were created to function. Directly. Direct experience. Direct knowing. Direct experiencing. No intermediary is necessary. But that's beyond the scope of what we need to accomplish. We need to simply choose a new idea. Exchange belief systems. The ego has this belief system that we've invested in and gets us nowhere. It distracts us, actually. Misdirects us. And so, spiritual progress is to pull away from that misdirection and that distraction and start to contemplate what the remedy really is and start to see its all-inclusive remedial function, to be able to do that. And there's very little evidence that that's taking place in the world. I've not been able to locate much of that at all. I mean, much of the self-inquiry does focus on the I, question of the I. Is there really an I there? And we're told that there is not, which is true. There is no actual I. I am this person or something. There's no such thing. There's no center to our personality. Doesn't exist. We're not a person. There is no real person. Much of the inquiry centers on that. But truly, what we must do is exchange belief systems. Because even if we see there's no I, Where does that leave us? We could still say, well, we need to establish an I. Or we could get worried and say, well, there's no I there, but I need to find one. I need to get one. I'm having trouble locating it, but if it's not there, well, I need to go to work and build one, construct one, or maybe eventually I will evolve so I have one, etc., etc. It doesn't... There's too many loopholes there. But if one sees the origin of the whole situation, it's simply a choice on the part of spirit to be prime creator and to realize that this is impossible. This brings it to the ultimate point of resolution, where one can choose the actual remedy, which is to choose a new idea. Now, abiding in the self means to abide in, experience the overlay. Now, Ramana Maharshi said, do self-inquiry, find out where the I thought came from, which is, of course, to trace it back to the choice that spirit made. That's where the I thought came from. It came from an attempt to misdirect, for spirit to hide its authorship of this whole situation and to think that there's something we're supposed to work on. That's where it came from. So trace that back, see that the true authorship of the situation, see that's impossible, and then choose a new idea. And from that comes the experience of what's called the capital S-E-L-F, self of the overlay, which is a reminder. It's not what we are. It's a reminder of what we are. So we abide not in what we are, but in the perfect reminder of what we are. And self-inquiry in the form of who am I is one way to work back to the root. It's not the only way. Recognizing what the remedy must be, that it must be to exchange belief systems, then also brings us right back to automatically includes that we chose an idea that cannot be truly experienced, that it's impossible to experience it. We need to see that. The idea of trying to be prime creator is not an idea we can truly experience. What we do is we literally have to try and forget what we are. And that's not a real experiencing. Because if we totally forget what we are, how could we be experiencing this total forgetfulness of what we are if we're not what we are? You know, it's a very conflicted, chaotic, crazy notion, isn't it? That somehow we can both completely and perfectly forget what we are and yet still experience this perfect forgetting of what we are. Who is doing the forgetting then? Who's doing the experiencing of this forgetting? It would have to be that which has been perfectly forgotten, which is a complete, you know, contradiction, isn't it? Total contradiction. So it's just all nonsense. We know deep down there's something really messed up with what we're trying to do, that it doesn't really work, and we can't figure out a remedy for it, and we're expecting that these teachers and gurus and saviors and avatars and bodhisattvas and saints, sages, etc., somehow have worked this out for us, and how we can forget what we are and still experience this forgetting of what we are. And we assume that's what they know, they've figured it out. But in fact, they haven't figured it out. What they tell us is there is no figuring out, because it's impossible. You have to drop the attempt to do it. Punjaji says, call off the search, meaning stop looking for an answer which doesn't exist. Stop looking for an I which isn't there. And this all seems pretty obvious when we're hearing it, but then when we're not hearing it, it seems like it's vanished. Because there's no support for it in the world. Which is the problems of the time. Nobody's trying to exchange belief systems, really. we're trying to work with the one we have and make it better, improve it. And it's very difficult for anyone to hold a certain belief system when there is zero support for it in the world. Practically zero. Very difficult, really. So I can be as clear as a bell, but as I go about the day, I experience nothing but complete unconsciousness compared to what I was clear about. And zero interest and zero support, and simply no inkling that such a clarity and belief could ever even arise. And it's like a massive vacuum almost that tends to just pull the clarity into a black hole. So it even disappears for me, disappears. Which is why theological and religious institutions, spiritual institutions, are places where there's a congregation, a true congregation, is very helpful, because one feels empowered to believe in this way, and other, because there are others that they're also doing the same. And it's easier to maintain continuity with this and go deeper and deeper. But there's not a lot of that in the world which is pointing to the remedy. There's a lot of spirituality in the world, yes. But as again, I said, that is sponsored by the ego. Even the ego can use all the terms, all the spiritual terms, the holy terms, whatever terms it wants to use, it can use those and make any claims it wants to, which it does. So, that is not the issue, no matter how much pomp and circumstances and high-sounding speech, etc., is used. That doesn't mean that the situation is actually pointing to the only remedy there is. So there is this problem, this difficulty in the world, which is one of reinforcement. And, you know, it seems like it doesn't matter how many videos I make, it's never enough to bring about the, you know, effective reinforcement if one is in a situation where there isn't a structural, abiding type of reinforcement in the fabric of one's life. We've gotten so far away from that, it's truly incredible. Before one eats, one should and always invoke clarity about the one remedy. Before one goes anywhere, one should invoke that. One should use that in conversation, as openings for conversation, and greeting people, and saying goodbye to them. All of that, it should be worked in the very fabric of our life. And there are echoes of that. In India, they say namaste, or, you know, peace to you. They put their hands together, you know, peace to you. You know, that's part of the fabric of a spiritual culture, is you set the social situation off on the right foot. I've never experienced that in a Western culture. Social interactions are never engaged in by setting the tone, the right tone, getting started on the right foot, never. So they always go awry. Everything should be put in the right context of the situation. This is an opportunity to reinforce awareness of the one remedy there is, and that we acknowledge this. That's the way it should be. It's not that way at all right now. And because it's not that way at all, it's easy to get way, way, way off track. And we have gotten way, way, way off track. As a world, as a culture. we've gotten off track because we've been entranced by the new methodology of sharing information, of accessing information, and we're not looking at the meaning of the information, rather we're looking at the method of the message. Marshall McLuhan said that the medium is the message, and he is very, very accurate about that. The medium has become the message, which is a gross, upside-down, backwards situation. Take the tech titans one by one, and ABM, set them side by side by the great saviors and avatars and gurus, sages, etc., and ask yourself, which one of those knows the key to your freedom from suffering and misery? Which one of them do you trust? ABM, put them side by side, the tech titans, you know who they are, the big founders and CEOs of the major tech titans in the world. We all know what they are. Take those founders and CEOs, etc., and put them next to Ramana Maharshi, Anandamayi Ma, etc., the great gurus, and ask yourself, who really is telling me the truth about how I can be freed from suffering and misery? Who really knows the answer? And it's just blatantly obvious. But people are worshiping the method, the medium. They're not paying any attention to the actual message. It's just really cool that they're accessing something in a new way, some gadget. But they're really accessing garbage. And they're overlooking this. It doesn't matter because it's cool. Because it's new. Because it's a different way of accessing. And we've become obsessed with this blatant folly. Mesmerized by it. Nobody is paying any attention to the content, the meaning, the true value of what's being accessed. It's the accessing itself which is valued, not what is being accessed. So everyone believes they're making great progress, and yet what they're accessing is garbage. So where's the progress? It's like we can access now 1,000 TV channels, and we can do it on mobily, you know? I mean, nobody seems to care that the content on all these 1,000 channels is just garbage. Zero information there about how to truly, what the true sovereign remedy is for our misery and suffering. Zero. But nobody seems to care at all. They say, well, I got all these channels and I can watch them, and, you know, anywhere I want, anywhere in the world now. I can be on a tropical island somewhere and I can still hook up my home TV and I can watch what's on this television channel, and overlooking entirely what the quality of the content really is. Amazing. That's why I call the world situation sophisticated savages. Really, the world is barbaric right now because it's got things upside down and backwards. Its values have been flipped. Which is what Jiddu Krishnamurti warned us about. He said this would happen. He saw it coming from a long way off. And it has happened in spades. It's really happened severely. And so we're looking for a big boost. Hasn't come yet. And we're wondering how can it arrive? How can we be truly helped? Yes, we know the answer, which is to exchange belief systems. A Course in Miracles pointed that out very clearly, starting in 1974. That was publicly, privately, there were study groups before that. And before that, Ramana said, abide in the self. We know that. Ananda Maima said, you must have the vision of oneness. We know that. Christ says, you must follow me. I am the way. Christ is the way. The overlay is the way. We know that. Buddha said, you must reach nirvana. We know that. The rishis and the great sages talked about samadhi. Must reach that. Etc., etc., etc. We must do that. We know all that. But are we doing it? Have we done that? I don't see evidence of it. Maybe it's hiding, but I doubt it. It's pretty difficult to hide this. I mean, the sages are not under some rock somewhere hiding. People notice them and say, what in the world is going on with you? What is this? There's a gravitation in that direction. Because they've accepted the overlay, made the exchange of belief systems. And yet this has happened and happened in the world, and yet here we are at this time with a world under the influence of this insanity of overlooking content for the purpose of marveling at the means of accessing that content, which is madness. And this madness is so strong now that it's causes us to forget quickly. So I'm concerned that these videos, even though they contain reminders, the forgetting is powerful in all of us. Because the expectations, the field of expectations in this world is so strong right now that it takes us away from focusing on the one remedy that there is. It's expected that we will not look there. It's expected that we value the means instead of the meaning. That we just pay no attention to the meaning, but only the attention of the means of accessing stuff. How do we access stuff? What new gadget is available to, for that we can access it in some slightly different way? Slightly faster, you know, faster access is a big deal. Different places we can access, faster access, more access, longer access. So what is the answer to the situation here that has arisen in spite of many teachers coming into the world? 20th century had quite a few. And we know their names. Some better known than others. Krishnamurti said, once this system is put in place, that's in place now, things will be very bad for us here. Very bad. That's why he insisted on great urgency. But how many actually made the exchange of belief systems based on his warning us haven't found any. How many awoke because of my ma saying, you know, you must have the vision of oneness and you must pursue this as fast as possible. How many truly woken? I don't know. I've not met any. Now, Ramana, maybe there are a few from him, and then from, for instance, Papaji, maybe there's some from him, possible. But we're looking for crumbs here. So is this situation simply meant to have its way with us, that we have no recourse, really? So these are the questions that we should be asking, because even though we know what to do, we're not really doing it. Of Course in Miracles, I really have not seen anyone that has really done it, who's truly exchanged belief systems, that's truly chosen a new idea, that's truly abiding in the vision of oneness, that is actually experiencing the overlay. Because it's easy to tell, just A, B it, to one that did, for instance, Ramana Maharshi or Nanda Mai Ma. There's two right there who unquestionably abided in the vision of oneness constantly. And so we can just use those as touchstones and ask ourselves, are we like that? Just like that? Because there's a quality of constancy and permanence in them, unwaveringness. You can feel it. When you look at them, you feel this quality, and you say, that's different. That's a different quality than in the pundits, you know. There are plenty of pundits, like myself. And we don't have it. Plenty of sages that don't have it. They know about it, very clear about it, but they haven't actually chosen a new idea. Because it's easy to tell this. If you have a cornerstone, one of the reasons why Ananda Mayama has been largely overlooked and forgotten is because she is perhaps the best cornerstone of all, and the ego doesn't like that. The ego says, don't look there. Because if you do look there, you are not fooled by all the sages and pundits, etc., who have not yet chosen a new idea, but who are simply talking along those lines. Myself, I'm able to freely say I have not chosen it, because I came across Ananda Mayama and Ramana Maharshi, and I saw them, and I said, oh, that is very clear-cut, 100% for sure they've done it. No doubt. And so, therefore, they are an accurate touchstone to compare with. And by having this, it becomes very easy to stop wasting time with those who don't have it. One is not fooled by those who don't have it. Not so fooled. One says, you know, the sages may say a lot of great things and be very helpful, yes. But only those who actually have it, who've actually made that choice, those are the ones who are actually trustworthy. You know, they will just tell you, just abide in the self, Ramana. You know, he wouldn't mislead you. He's just saying there's only one way. And Jesus, same thing, there's only one way. That's the greatest teaching. There's only one way. That's it. And that is vision of Christ, vision of oneness. Abidance in the self, the overlay. Experience the overlay. It's the only way. It's the only remedy. Only that brings about remembrance of what we really are. We need perfect remembrance because we're perfect. We need flawless remembrance because we're flawless. We need incorruptible remembrance because we're incorruptible. We need never-ending remembrance because we're never-ending, because we're eternal. That's the remembrance we need. Only that provides the true remembrance of what we are. The information that the sages give us in various ways does not provide the remembrance of what we are. So in really helpful cultural situations, there are touchstones. And everyone in there reveres those touchstones and uses them to make sure everyone knows where they're at. And there's no self-deception as to where one's at. One realizes that they're on the path, that they're getting closer, etc. But they know that they're not there yet. So, touchstones are invaluable. That's why I keep bringing them up. Indispensable, really. I know some gurus who were really imposters in some way, and they had trouble with these touchstones. They didn't really like dealing with them at all. Tried to avoid mentioning them, some of them, so they wouldn't be outed, you know. They may try to cozy up to one of them or ignore the touchstones, the real touchstones, as if they didn't exist. Because if you see the real touchstones, then you are able to look at the imposter gurus and say, ah, you know, that this one is just an amateur. You know, really, they're posers, not real, not the real thing. And then you don't get caught up in their insanity and madness, which at times, that's what takes place, as the effort to keep the whole charade going involves more and more troublesome situations. So with these true touchstones, we're able to stay on course, not deceive ourselves. We may have plenty of experiences, like spiritual, psychic, various types of experiences, but we know that's not it. Because we don't have this unwavering, perfect, flawless remembrance of what we are. Effortless. Which is the effect of choosing a new idea. Which is the effect of abidance in the self. Abidance in the overlay. Experiencing the overlay. Choosing a new idea. Exchanging belief systems. It brings that permanent, perfect, flawless peace beyond understanding. Seamless. Not wavering. Not like a candle flame fluttering all over the place with the wind. No matter how much the wind is blowing, the flame doesn't move at all. Steady. All the psychic phenomena in the world cannot compensate for the lack of this. All of the guru games cannot compensate for a lack of this. So when the world forgets these touchstones, you know it's going in a very bad direction. Because what happens is then fake gurus, fake pundits, teachers, whatever, can arise, and the world will worship them and think that they're following someone that can really lead them truly. When in fact, what happens is you end up worshipping the teacher and following them and thinking they're the way and trying to empower them, and they use you to empower themselves and try to gain stability within existence for themselves, trying to gain some high position where they have all these servants serving them, trying to beautify their surroundings for them and take care of their every need and make their lives somehow rich and fulfilled that way. That's not where it's at all. So as we forget these touchstones, we know that's a severe sign of a civilization in drastic decay, which is why I've tried to keep alive these touchstones my whole life. I've promoted saints and sages and said, you've got to keep this alive in the forefront. Every morning you should get up and you should look at these great realized beings who have chosen to exchange belief systems, chosen a new idea, and experiencing the flawless remembrance of what they are. And you should look at them and keep that in your mind throughout the day and realize this is the goal. This is what I have to do, attain to. Anything other than that is non-attainment. and then you won't waste as much time. You'll see other teachers and pundits and sages, etc., doing their thing, and that's fine, and you can get help and encouragement in that way. But you'll still know that you haven't attained. You'll have various dreams, various experiences that may be incredible. I've had many many incredible experiences, seemingly of the highest type, but it's not it. That is not attainment. I don't know to say exactly what it is, but I do know what it's not, and it's not attainment. You can be initiated by the highest, highest of the high, but if you do not have guidance in the overlay, if you do not choose a new idea, exchange belief systems, and give up the effort to be prime creator and choose not to be prime creator, if you don't do that, you don't have attainment. Period. So there's no point even talking about attainment. I don't want to talk about my attainment because I don't have any. I'm able to work at the level of clarification, which is sort of a mid-level situation of helpfulness. But there's no attainment there. There's only one attainment, and that's the vision of Christ, vision of oneness, experiencing the overlay. That's the only attainment there is. There's only one attainment. Everything else doesn't deserve to be mentioned as attainment at all. Any talk of it as attainment only slows one down. One's feeling this should be one hasn't attained anything. But as long as one realizes there's only one attainment to attain, then realizing one hasn't attained it yet is not such a bad thing, because one realizes, well, I have, at least I'm clarifying this and moving closer to this one attainment, and not getting bogged down by trying to claim attainment when it's not really attainment. There's endless ways to fake attainment, to do something that one defines as attainment, but it's not really that. Endless ways, lots of teachers teaching those ways. And that's par for the course, par for existence. That's what the ego does. Ego always has massive amounts of stuff going on. How to, you know, change this, change that, give a slightly different buzz to a situation, make shift this way, shift that way, endless stuff. None of it is attainment. And again, the problem with the direction the world is going in, I see it as a dire, dire situation, because the cornerstones are being ignored. Which means a world then can easily give rise to endless false substitutes and compensations, and then the people will have no way of knowing that it's false, really. They'll be easily get into all that stuff, which is time-wasting, and they'll easily get into then boasting about attainments when they don't have any, when they don't have the one attainment. And then you can easily get into very decadent, decaying, morbid situations that seem to be laced with spirituality, but it's just nothing but a house of cards. And you can have all these spiritual masters and teachers of every type. And we won't realize that they're not teaching attainment. They themselves don't have any attainment. But with the cornerstones, it's easy to, we know right away. So, I have tried to keep alive these cornerstones. I dedicated my life to that, and it's really, I've gotten nowhere. It's been a waste of time. Because when the world is intent on something, it will go there. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. I led the archiving project for Ananamaima, trying to keep her pictures alive in the world. Did this for many, many years. Did a tremendous amount of work on trying to archive all the pictures and make them available to the world so that people would have this cornerstone. I felt it was absolutely essential, because you're never going to find a better cornerstone than Ananamaima, because she was a perfect cornerstone. Perfect touchstone, rather. A touchstone where her consciousness never identified with the physical body, with this worldly body at all. Never. Not before birth, not during birth, not after birth, and not after death. Throughout all eternity, she says that the dance of creation will dance in the halls of creation, but she remains ever the same. So there was perfect non-identification with this whole existence, always abided perfectly in perfect remembrance of what she was, of reality, of the true self, spirit. So perfect touchstone. So I said, you know, very valuable for people to have this touchstone, because there's actually, you know, photographs and videos which you convey this quality. And so that one knows what attainment really is. And then this enables one to focus in on attainment instead of getting sidetracked by all these, you know, carnival barkers who say, come on in to this, you know, to this sideshow. You can say, well, you know, where's the beef? Where's the attainment? No attainment? Then let me look at it from that perspective. So for here I'm saying no attainment. For me, no attainment. Because I know what attainment really is. I've not only glimpsed it, but I'm aware of the corner of the touchstones of Ramana Maharshi and Ananamaima, to name two. And if you have two, that's plenty. Even if you have one, that's enough. Again, perfect abidance in the self, perfect experiencing the overlay, meaning perfect experiencing of flawless, perfect remembrance of what one is, that one is spirit. One is not trying to forget that at all. That is attainment. Nothing else is attainment. I don't care if you're a ruler of the universe. If you don't have perfect remembrance of what you really are, there's no attainment. Without touchstones, we cannot build up a culture that's focused on attainment. We build up the present culture, which is everything but focus on attainment. And that's why attainment is so rare right now. There's all sorts of insight. All sorts of insight. Yeah, there's no I. There's no I. That's insight. All sorts of clarification. There is no I. But that's not attainment. The world has very conveniently set aside these touchstones. And my effort to prevent this has been a battle that seems to be lost, a losing battle. So the question is what to do. If the world has no interest in touchstones, what can one do? The world is only interested in egoic attainment. Ways to manipulate the effects of existence, which is no attainment at all. Ways to avoid choosing a new idea, exchanging belief systems. So I have not seen attainment in this world. It's not happening. We've kind of lowered the bar and redefined what attainment is by overlooking the touchstones, really. Or by using them in ways which seem to tricky ways. But either one either has it or they don't. The attainment is cut and dried. There's no two ways about it. It's not partial. One doesn't have partial attainment. No such thing. I've had experiences where I've been told I've made all sorts of grades and advancements, etc. But for me, there's no attainment. Those things are pretty meaningless. I'm a teacher, spiritual master, this and this and that. Doesn't mean anything. No attainment. There's only one attainment. No other. No half attainments. It's either or, black and white. Light or dark, truth or lies, cut and dried. And the less we work on fooling one another with fake attainment, the quicker we can progress, actually. So it's very helpful, I believe, to point this out for those who are willing to hear it. It should be a welcome message. A knee-jerk reaction on the surface may be to think it's troublesome, but in looking at it more carefully, one can easily see that it will save a massive amount of time. Nothing wastes time more than posing as having some sort of attainment that one doesn't have and getting entangled in that. Because all that it does is attracts others who want to claim the same false attainment. Say, yeah, let's form a little club and we'll all agree, you know, that we have these attainments. And then all the troubles arise. Everybody's looking for someone who has a fake attainment so that they can latch onto that and learn how to pose, be posers as well with fake attainments. Fake attainment. All this is very common. This is the warp and the woof of the spiritual path and the spiritual marketplace of the world. Everyone sees this. Jockeying for some sort of position, instead of having a very secure system with cornerstones, with touchstones, front and center, and emphasizing that there's only one attainment. Anything less than that is nothing, really. Sure, there are those who have greater clarity and have gotten closer towards attainment, yet they still don't have any. None. All of this, a sane, wise culture incorporates all of this. And each situation is a teaching moment. Everyone remembers, hey, there is attainment. That's our responsibility. That's our goal. We must choose a new idea. We have no choice. It's not up to us to set what our options are. We either have deep forgetfulness of what we are or deep remembrance. Those are the only two options we have. And deep forgetfulness is only temporary. So we have to choose deep remembrance of what we are. So that's the one goal we all share, and we recognize this is our purpose here in life, and we support each other in doing this. And we support a culture that supports this, and that should be recognized in every interaction. And in this way, we will eventually have attainment. I guess that's a nice word to use. Instead of enlightenment, realization, attainment. And now the cat has come back here after he went across the street and went somewhere and had a little adventure. Now he's back and saying, I'm ready to go inside and sleep now. Okay. Very great. He said I was looking for false attainment, but now I realize there's only one attainment. So I've come back to work on that. But the question is, what do we do in the present time still remains unanswered. I'm trying to find the answer to that. I've tried so many things. My whole life I have spearheaded efforts to emphasize the touchstones and to tell people that they must incorporate that into their lives. But this has not been effective. And there really are not significant numbers of touchstones living in the world right now. And compared to the perfect touchstones, which I say, perfect touchstones are the only real type there are. One has to have unwavering abidance in the self, to really remember the self, to unwavering abidance in experiencing the overlay, steady, the overlay steady. So only those who have this effortless steadiness of this flawless peace, only that's attainment, and it's just difficult to find that in the world right now. So what do we do? Again, I'm not sure. But at least we must talk about this and bring it up as a question. So I'm still trying to do my best for the world. Being frustrated in ineffectual actions here, and yet to speak about these actions and to put it into a context is in itself helpful. At least we know what the problem is, which is a big step in the right direction. We lack these touchstones. We lack understanding of the importance of these touchstones. Lack a culture that is incorporating these touchstones and built around recognition of there's only one attainment. We lack all of that. But in seeing that we lack it, that puts us at least in a better position. All right. I think this cat wants to go inside now. So, very great. That's it.